Welcome back to the Sprott Money News monthly precious metals projections video. Hey, I'm your host, Craig Hemke. Joining us as usual is our guest, Christopher Mulin of thetechnicaltraders.com. This is a free service from Sprott Money. We've gotten a lot of positive feedback, so we're happy to keep doing it. Chris, thank you so much for joining me here in July.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Craig.
Hey, this is a lot of fun, and we've got a lot of questions for you this month. Before we get to it, just a couple of reminders. One, this content all comes from SprottMoney.com. So you want to support them. You want to, if you want to help us spread the word, maybe give us a like, a subscribe, make sure we get this, all these different podcasts out on all the different channels that you listen to it. And then additionally, you know, a lot of us are collecting physical precious metal at some clearly discounted prices. You got to store that stuff somewhere, and you can store it with Sprott Money. We've got 6 secure locations globally. Great way to store it, economical way to store it. And of course, you can always find out more by going to SprottMoney.com or giving them a call at 888-861-0775. We'll talk about the precious metals in a minute, but Chris, we got a couple big picture topics to cover first. Like I said, we've collected questions over the last few weeks of people that kind of want to hear straight from you. One of them kind of deals with larger cycles. You know, I know you're monitoring things every single day. And as you've told us, your process is always finding the best asset now. Mm-hmm. In terms of longer cycles, though, there are some analysts out there that look in, you know, like the 3 and 5 year and 10 year category trying to find longer cycles. Those mean much to you, or are you kind of always just checking things and keeping track of things short term?
I keep my eyes on them. I mean, they're so big and slow moving. There's not a whole lot to be done when you look at them. It's nice to get a feel for where I think we are in these cycles. I do think we're starting a really big super cycle to the upside for the commodity space in general. I think we're very similar to what we saw back in 2003, 2002, where we saw commodities put in a major bottom. They became very undervalued. They were, you know, almost like 100-year undervalued levels compared to the stocks and in real estate. And we were back at that just last year, really. Commodities were the lowest value in terms of how they related to the equities market and real estate. They're just out of favor. They were the lowest kind of value. And when something hits bottom and other things are totally inflated and screaming higher and everyone's chasing prices up, that's usually a sign that we're starting another major cycle. So I think we're already probably 2 years into a new super cycle. I think we could see commodities rally for 3 to 5 years. And I think there's a lot of upside, and it's going to be very interesting to see how this plays out. Obviously, we're kind of in a perfect storm. We have been in a perfect storm for precious metals for a while. They haven't really taken off yet. But I do think we're getting into a scenario where eventually we're going to see those really break free, that gold is going to go ballistic, you know, 2,700, 3,400, all these different areas to the upside. These are big patterns. They're going to take years to unfold. It's not going to happen this year. Probably not, you know, see those levels reach till next year. But I think we're in a new super cycle to the upside.
All right. Well, to that end, you know, we talk a lot about gold and the miners and silver and things like that every month. We had a couple questions come in this month, though, talking about the stock market, because it's been such a tumultuous couple of weeks. But yet the stock market keeps on plowing higher, regardless of earnings, regardless of what interest rates are doing, you know, regardless of like the reverse repo situation, mm-hmm. just keeps on moving higher. What do you think of, let's call it the S&P at this point?
Yeah, I mean, the S&P 500 is continuing to grind higher. I mean, if I was to share my chart real quick, you can see the S&P 500. This is a monthly chart of the S&P 500 going back to 2000. And more or less, the monthly chart, we just keep going up. I mean, it's starting to get pretty parabolic. We've had this massive climb out of the COVID crash. But, you know, the trend is still up. This market could continue to climb. And it's in nosebleed section. But you don't want to go picking a top, because this market could keep going higher and higher. I mean, people were picking tops back in 2015, 2016, and really all through this whole last time frame. And the market just keeps going higher. So you got to trade with the trend. The trend is your friend, but we are starting to see signs, especially in the last trading week. we're starting to see signs that the market is getting a little more unstable. The price action we've seen in gold, in oil in the past, the first week of July, really big volatility in terms of price swings and intraday price swings. We're seeing the dollar start to kind of break and push higher. And the biggest thing is we're seeing bonds. Bonds are starting to come to life, the treasury bonds, and they're starting to really pick up speed. Very similar. If I was to take a look at the TLT bond ETF and just move, I'm going to go to the daily chart because this will give you a really good view of what I think is starting to unfold. So if we zoom back at bonds, bonds put in this big consolidation back over here, had a huge rally up, big consolidation, and then bonds started to break out and rally back over here. Now, this is December and January of last year, just before COVID. Bonds started to take off, utilities started to perform well, precious metals were starting to pick up speed, and we're seeing the same type of price action right now. If I was to just zoom in a little bit here, we've seen the bond market more or less kind of trade sideways through this area. It finally broke out, and now it's just starting to really take off. And that's telling us that big money is starting to get defensive. They're starting to move into the bond market. The bond market is huge, so it takes a lot of money to move it. And when bonds start outperforming the stock market, that's not a good sign. That means more money is going into this defensive sector or group as asset than they are into the equities. And this can happen for several months. We saw this back last year. We saw bonds outperform for about 2 months before the stock market crashed. So it's just an early warning sign that there is big money starting to get very defensive. And if you can feel it in the market, it's starting to chatter. We're starting to see some volatility, some big bouts of selling, but then buyers step back in and drive the price back up. So I'm getting a little nervous, but we got to stick with the trend, which is still up at this point. Eventually we're going to, you know, have to liquidate, move to cash and see what kind of correction or sell-off the stock market has.
So not the worst asset now just yet, but we talk about, you mentioned that every month, you know, that what you like to call the best asset now, always keeping track of all the different sectors and even components within each sector. The final question we had this month had to deal with the worst asset now. Do you ever look at it that way? And do you have anything you want to share with us that looks particularly terrible?
Yeah. So if we take a look at the band, the best asset now hot list, and we actually scroll down to the bottom, the worst performing sectors right now are PBW, which is a clean energy ETF. It's sold off dramatically from the highs. It's trying to build a base, but it continues to underperform. We're also looking at XBI, which is a biotech sector. It's been underperforming. A lot of these were leaders last year, and they've sold off a lot. If you look at the sell-off that they had, biotechs fell 31%. They're still down, you know, 25% from the highs, PBW down dramatically. But believe it or not, down near the bottom of this list is the SILJ, the Silge, the Silver Miner Juniors. It's still struggling. I mean, when you look at this chart, I mean, it's a pretty ugly chart when you just look at this consolidation it's had over the last year, more or less, just sideways chop. And it's really going nowhere with a lot of volatility at this point. So it's a pretty bad asset to try and get into. It's noisy. You're probably going to get shaken out. Same with the GDX. Believe it or not, the gold miners are still struggling. They had the wind taken out of their sails about a week and a half ago when the US dollar broke out, rallied, and we just saw precious metals collapse. They were primed and ready to take off, but the dollar just, you know, broke out, and it definitely took the wind out of these sails. And now they're struggling. They're at a support level trying to find support to move up, but they just haven't found that traction yet. So these are the ones that are kind of lagging. That the way it works, a lot of these were leaders last year, and now they're the worst performing, and that's called sector rotation. So what is out of favor will eventually come back into favor and be a big performer. So there's nothing wrong with them being at the bottom of the list. The only thing is they're a hard trade to make money on when they're trending lower and they're very kind of sideways. You're better to wait for them to start outperforming and becoming leaders and then follow them. So right now, this is the kind of bottom of the barrel. You've got these kind of sector ETFs down at the bottom here.
All right. Well, you mentioned the dollar. When we spoke a month ago, as you said, we looked pretty good. GDX was kind of flagging nicely. Gold was trying to get above 1900. Silver's trying to get up 28. And we had an FOMC meeting about 3 weeks ago, and the dollar spiked out of that. And what had some trappings of a short covering, short squeeze. So you got up through the 50 day and the 200 day. Man, that was all it took. The machines saw the spike in the dollar and they just sold everything dollar related, whether that was gold, silver, the mining shares, as you mentioned. So let's talk about the dollar.
Yeah,
it looked, caught my eye and added some concern a couple of weeks ago because it broke through that 200 day, then came back now over about a 3 or 4 day period and tested it as support and then blasted higher again. And now we're making new highs versus those highs a couple of weeks ago. Looks to be a little tired though, Chris. I know the daily RSI has been overbought in the 70 plus range quite a few times in the last couple of weeks. So this seems to be a primary driving factor of the trade these days. Where do you see the dollar and how does it look from here?
Yeah, so the dollar was putting in this rounding formation that you and I had talked about back when it was down here. And we talked about how if it breaks here, it's going to pop. It's going to have a very quick rally. And that's what it did. We had the meeting, the news came out, we saw a huge pop, and that's what created the collapse in precious metals. And since then, it is pushing up. It's getting closer to these highs and it's starting to look a little bit exhausted, but we're going to have to see if this can break. If we see the US dollar break 93.50, we're going to probably see another very big move to the upside in the dollar. And that's going to put a lot of pressure on metals still. And they're probably going to be out of favor for a while. I still feel like the dollar is going to hold up fairly well. I think it's going to trade up in this range or sideways. That's going to keep pressure on gold, silver, and miners. And we need to see which way it's going to break, if it's going to reverse down. But the thing is, it's in a short-term uptrend right now, and there's still more upside potential in the dollar. And I think we could still see another leg down in precious metals and miners that point to about a 7 to 8% drop in the miners specifically and silver before we see a bottom. So I think there's still more wiggle room, but eventually the US dollar is going to have a much larger drop. If we look at the monthly chart of the dollar, we're looking at a break below 88, around 88.40 or 88 in general. Eventually, when the dollar breaks this level and collapses down to the 80 or 75 range, that's when we're going to see, I think, that huge commodity surge and rally. A lot of commodities, they're based in US dollars. And more or less, this breakout and rally that we saw back in 2014, I think we could see that actually unwind and sell off all the way down to 75. And that's going to spark, I think, just this huge precious metals rally. And it's going to become that's what's going to spark everyone to want it and create a huge parabolic move in gold and silver. So I'm excited for when that happens. But when you look at this chart, this is a monthly chart. I think we could still see several months of the dollar trading sideways in this range before it starts to break down. And that means precious metals are probably still going to struggle and trade sideways for a little while.
To that end, you know, I've been watching on my site, and I mentioned it earlier, the RSI, the Relative Strength Index, you know, a measure of momentum. And the dollar just so rarely, if you go back and look at the daily chart, it gets above 70 or below 30, you know, overbought or oversold. Back on March the 30th, when we had that peak up there to 93.40, 93.50, that RSI got up like to 71 or two. And I thought, oh man, that's the highest it'd been in over a year.
Yep.
And you can see what happened next. Well, I mean, we got to 73 a couple of weeks ago and then, you know, pulled back and got about 73 again. And now we're pushing back towards 70. I mean, do you put much a stock into momentum figures like that? Or you figure, you know, if it's overbought, it can stay overbought and just keep going.
Yeah. So I fall into the camp of your later comment there. I think when RSI is above, you know, above 70, that to me is the power zone. It's outperforming, it's leading, it's more likely that's when it's going to have some of the biggest moves to the upside. And I think that's where a lot of people, and that's how the band strategy plays. We want to find the leaders, the ones outperforming. They're all going to have their RSI way up in the upper range, and they just keep on going and going and going. And I don't use it as an overbought, oversold. I look at it as when it's over that 70 line and it's starting to shade in green or whatever your indicator shows. To me, it's almost like muscle flexing. It's like the stock or that commodity is flexing its muscle, saying it's strong here. It's performing better than it has in the past. And that's what RSI is. It's comparing itself to its own price in history. And it's saying it's stronger than it has been, you know, in the past. And so that's a sign that it's likely going to keep going. So
okay.
when the RSI is high, that's when we're going to get some of these biggest moves to the upside. Eventually it will top out and the RSI will break down. But usually I'm looking for that breakdown below 70. And that's usually the sign where it's lost its kind of momentum and, okay. And it should All right. continue to go down.
All right. Well, again, this has clearly been impacting the metals. As you said, rates have been falling as bonds have been rallying. Inflation expectations are still very high. In fact, the TIP ETF, as we record this, is making new all-time highs. So why are the metals down? Well, again, these computers see the dollar rallying, and then they take action by selling COMEX metal futures. So let's take a look at gold, and then we'll begin to wrap up with a few other items.
Sure.
We broke down, took out 3 weeks ago, both of the key moving averages, the 50-day and the 200-day, over a period of about 48 hours. We're struggling to get back up there. It looks like it's got some overhead resistance up near 1820, 30, maybe 1840. And I mean, you never make it all back. And, you know, you might take the elevator down, as they say, but it's always the stair steps back up.
Yeah.
You look at this gold chart, Chris. What levels would be important to you to either hold a support or accomplish getting above as resistance as we, you know, as we go from here?
Yeah, I think this pink line here is the 20-day and the blue line is the 50-day. So this little blue circle I drew here, this could be a pretty critical resistance area. It's also a point where we had high volume right through or two bars sold off, and then it kind of rallied up and sold off. There's a lot of volume through here. And then, of course, we had a pivot low here. It broke through here. There was a high, it broke through, kind of a spike low and a recovery, another low. So this is a pretty significant, this 1810 to 18 kind of 20 or 1815 areas is going to act as a pretty good resistance area. We pushed up huge yesterday, which was, what was that? That was July 6th. We pushed up, it was up almost 2% gold, and then it reversed and sold back down. It's trying to push back up into that resistance area again. So there's obviously overhead supply and it's kind of unloading their contracts, and we're seeing the dollar push up. So this is a really critical line in the sand. I think if we get above that 1820, 1825 and can hold up in that range, I think maybe we've broken through there. We might actually start to head back up to the 1900 mark. Obviously, if we start to break this low around 1760 area, 1762, if it closes below there, I think we're going to very quickly drop down to that 1700. So it's in this sideways range. You could almost just box it in right here that this is a kind of a consolidation period. The big question is it going to break and resolve to the upside, or is it going to break and go back down for potentially a triple bottom? We've got one, two, and then this would be a triple bottom. I feel as though it's going to trade sideways here for a bit more. I actually feel like it's going to resolve to the downside and flush out a bit more. I think the dollar has got a little bit more room to go. But overall, when we look at the big picture of gold and look at the monthly chart, you can see we're still in this massive rally up, this big bull flag. It started to break out 2 months ago, and then it reversed back down with the dollar rally. And so it's trying to find support here to move up. I like this pattern. This is a very strong pattern. Obviously, we need to get resolve above these monthly highs around this 19. It'll really be around 1920 area. When we break above that and hold, that'll definitely be a very clear sign that, you know, we should be heading back up to 2000, 2600. So that's going to be a really significant reversal point in the chart when we get up there.
That's going to be a key one to watch, no doubt about it. And you mentioned the dollar. As you know, you get all this electronic trading, mainly during COMEX hours. The machines buy and sell those futures a lot of times based on the ticks of the dollar. And that carries over to all the commodities. And you see it in silver, you see it in copper, you can see it in crude oil. There's a proxy that you told me you use for commodities in general. And this gets to kind of that larger cycle that we mentioned as we began the show. You know, rising tide lifts all boats, Chris, obviously. So how do the general commodities look on the really long-term charts? Yeah, like you've got there, that's probably what, a monthly chart?
Yeah.
How do you feel about that trade? It was storming out of the COVID stuff a year and a half ago, consolidating a little bit maybe, but how do you feel about that trade in general?
Yeah, I think commodities are putting in I think they've put in a major bottom. You could argue that this big low over here and this kind of consolidation in this low, I kind of feel like this is kind of a major low in the commodities market. We've seen mm-hmm. a very strong rally coming out of here. We've kind of broken. If I was to just try and draw a line straight across here with the mouse, we've got this really significant line on this line across the chart that we've broken through. And it's a very significant level because we had 6-7 months trading sideways there. We had a few months trading through here. It hit a few more months over here. And now we've broken through that. We got nice volume. So I think commodities are now in a full on bull market. And I think they could pull back and consolidate as the dollar potentially pushes higher. But overall, I think we could see commodities eventually continue to rise. Now, this is DBC. This is a commodity index tracking ETF. And so it's heavily weighted in oil and precious metals. It does carry a lot of other things, but they're more heavy weighted in those. I do think we're going to see this eventually take off and move a lot higher. So this is a nice gauge, a line in the sand, not very straight lines here, but you get the point that they are now in a new bull market and they've had a beautiful run. So a pause or pullback for 3-4 months isn't the end of the world. It's actually going to be a really good thing that if it does have that, we can project where it should run next. Now, if it was to pull back a little bit here for a few months, the next upside target, it'll be somewhere probably around 26 to the 28 area, which is right in through the middle of this huge consolidation pattern where the majority of volume has traded in the past. So far this chart pattern looks like that's where it's pointing to, but we do need to see it pause and pull back. And that'll give us that measured move that it could hit. And that's what crude oil has done. Crude oil has gone all the way up and hit our $77 per barrel target. It hit it on July 6th and then reversed and fell 5%. And it was on one of these big, big projections that, you know, this is where this big trend is pointing to. Didn't sound like it could get there, but it did. And our next target is actually $88 per barrel for crude. So that'll definitely pull the commodity index in the space to the upside.
Again, that lifting all boats thing, you know, if that commodity index over the next, whatever it is, year and a half, 2 years, moves back from 20 to 30, that's 50%.
Yeah.
And I think we can all kind of figure where gold and silver might be at that point, and the mining shares. And let's conclude with whatever proxy you want to use for the mining shares, Chris. Again, is nasty breakdown these last 3 weeks. Lots of red candles where we might open higher, you know, or open lower, whatever, then sell off all day long to paint another red candle on the daily chart. We are, however, though, getting maybe into a, I don't know if seasonality is a right term, but the month of July, we'll start getting production results out of the miners, the big producers. And then as this month draws to a close and as August begins, you start getting earnings reports compared year over year and even quarter after quarter. The earnings are going to look pretty good. So the miners might start at least getting some positive attention on the chart. And again, using whatever proxy you want to use. How do we look after? Because that was a pretty gnarly little 3 weeks we just went through.
Yeah. So I've got the weekly chart of the Sprott Gold Miners ETF, SGDM. So if we look at the weekly chart, it gives us a kind of a good feeling of where the markets are. So more or less, we've had this multi-month consolidation. Mm-hmm. It's finally had a nice big push. It's moved up and now it's pulled back and it looks like it's trying to carve out a bottom. We had a little reversal mm-hmm. candle there. It's pushing up. I feel as though this is kind of, you know, the first kind of push up and this is the first pullback, very similar to kind of over here, you get the first push up and then you get the first pullback. So if the US dollar finds resistance where it is, it starts to fall. I think we're going to see miners and precious metals start their second run up. And we're going to see gold miners in general probably go back up and test last year's high, last July, August, test those highs. So this is what this chart pattern is pointing to at this point. I think you look at miners, there's going to be so much upside potential when the metals market does actually start to take off. This is the weekly chart. And from a weekly standpoint, this is a first pullback. It's actually a bullish thing. It is going to be pointing to higher prices. Now, if for all we know, it could flush down a little bit more. It could come back down to maybe a double bottom around 26, this particular ETF, before it goes higher. But overall, it's trying to build a base. This was a very strong run. There was a lot of momentum there. And just because we had some news with the dollar, it took some of the wind out of the sails, but overall, this is still a very strong pattern in the grand scheme of things that is pointing to higher prices. So I like miners, but again, they're at the bottom. They're kind of one of the best, the worst assets right now, just because they're still floundering. They're trying to carve out this bottom. There's going to be a very significant level here where miners need to break. They're trying to carve out this bottom. And if they can get above this area here, that's when we're going to see an explosive move up. And from there, I think they're going to go a heck of a lot higher.
Yeah, you know, Tavi Costa is a guy I know that runs or is one of the managers at Crescat Capital in Denver. And he's been posting chart after chart showing free cash flow, actual fundamental stuff that the mining companies are doing at these levels. But that doesn't seem to matter. Again, when the dollar's moving higher, I look one last thing on that chart. If you take all those little squiggly blue lines off of there, my friend, I mean, I'm just a big fan of symmetry. I look at that. I see maybe a reverse head and shoulder. I also see what looks to be, what was that, 7 months down, right? Yeah. And then as we go back up, that time frame between the shoulders is about the same.
Yeah.
So I just wonder if it's 7 months back up, up to that 40 level, which would get us there, I don't know, 3-4 months from now, maybe the end of the year. Then you'd have a big cup on the chart, you know, with a potential breakout. I mean, we'll just end that on a personal note. Do you see things that way, or do you try to keep your mind's eye a little
For sure I do. So I called it a rounding kind of formation, like a rounding bottom. It's trying to build a base. It's also an inverse head and shoulders, whatever you want to call it. I mean, it looks like it's trying to bottom. And this is going to be that critical level here when it breaks these highs. This high continues right across to more or less this high over here in these consolidations, a lot of lows and volume. So when it breaks this, and it's going to have a strong pop. And the way you measure just the simple head and shoulders is you take the distance from the neckline all the way to the tip of the head. And whatever that distance is, you can take that line, you can move it to the upside. And it's telling us, well, based on that momentum, that move, it should push us up to new highs around 41. I mean, it works really, really well. And so when we do hit that level, I mean, once we do break out, 41 is going to be where that momentum is probably going to stall out, which is how the markets work. You typically see the markets, you know, they rally up, they make a high, they pull back, they make a slightly higher high, and then they pull back. It kind of happens over and over again. Well, here's one high over here, and it's pulling back with a much larger pattern. And then it's going to go up to 41, which is that slightly higher high. And then it's going to pull back for a while. So all these patterns are pointing to much higher prices. It's showing a bottoming formation in inverse head and shoulders and higher prices. It's just a matter of time before I think the precious metals market actually plays out. It always takes longer than everybody anticipates or expects or wants. That's and for sure. It's just the way the market moves.
Yeah. And, you know, there's some value there as a contrarian play, it would seem too, since it's down the list that we showed as the show began. Chris, two things before we wrap up. One, tell everybody about your day job, the Technical Traders.
Sure. Yeah. So at the technicaltraders.com, you get my daily morning video before the market opens. And I run through all the charts and market sentiment, what the markets are doing, where they should be heading and resistance support levels. And whenever I do a trade with a sector ETF, then you can follow suit. Really educational. More or less, you kind of learn while you earn, and you become more or less a chartist. You learn to trade and read the charts, which you don't even have to do. Technically, you just follow the trade alerts. Some people just do that. But you can follow me there and be able to navigate these markets and avoid market crashes, which is the key part. Is we know when to move to cash. We use a lot of different cycles and market internals to gauge the momentum of the market so we can see when it's rolling over and step away from stocks when they collapse, and then we can move back in when they show signs of life again.
Yep. And hey, do me a favor. Don't check out yet. You got to see this. Chris has also built a website designed to make internet entrepreneurs, perhaps, of your kids. Maybe it's your grandkids who might have an interest in this. Still in its developing stages, but man, this is very cool. Chris, tell everybody about this little project you built.
Sure. So we're starting a project called Early Start, and the early is like a website. So this is, we're teaching kids how to build their first kind of one-page websites to sell products and services that they either make or they create and they can sell. It could be physical products. It could be a little digital product, but we're getting kids into the entrepreneurial space. And I've had my daughter, we've started to create these tutorials and she's created her own business. And now she's teaching her friends how to do it. And we just create this click by click, follow kind of me to success program where they follow my daughter and I, as we build websites and we help other kids. And they get to realize how easy it can be to build a business. And this process takes anywhere from an hour to 3 hours to build a little online business. And the kids absolutely love it. The confidence they get, the excitement they get, it's unbelievable. When they get an order, my daughter does hundreds of dollars in sales. And she runs to my office and she gets super excited. She's like, "Dad, I got another sale." She sold stuff in California and in Toronto, all kinds of different places. It's just really amazing when kids can create something from scratch around something they love, and it could be anything. And it just really opens the door. So we're just trying to teach kids how to become an entrepreneur at a young age, realize that they have control of what they're doing. And it's perfect for a classroom project, homeschooling, or just an extracurricular activity with your parents. So it's a really fun process. The kids have a blast. And so that's what we're trying to do. We're just trying to help kids get an early start on life, an early start on entrepreneurship. And that's the whole point of the strategy here.
Very, very cool. And again, when does the whole thing go live?
So we're planning for an August 30th launch. We're going to launch it on Kickstarter, which is a crowdfunding platform. We're creating a software platform where we've gamified it, which means these kids, as they complete these little tasks and levels, it's like a level in a game. They get rewards. They can use these rewards to improve their website and do all kinds of extra things that take their website to a whole new level. And they end up with these really professional little businesses that they own, that they get to run. And from there, we're going to run this crowdfunding campaign and launch the software and the program. And so that's how it'll go.
That is very, very cool. And we'll talk about it again next month. Make sure you're on track for the end of August. We'll make sure we talk about it again. And I'm sure we'll have no shortage of other topics to discuss next month too.
Yep,
again,
for sure.
Chris Vermeulen of thetechnicaltraders.com providing his monthly precious metals projections here at Sprott Money. Please keep Sprott Money in mind anytime you're in the market to buy precious metals or store precious metals. And again, anytime you have any questions, just pick up the phone and give them a call at 888-861-0775. Chris, thank you so much for your time. It's just been fantastic as usual.
All right. Well, thanks, Craig. Always a pleasure. Take care.
For all of us at Sprott Money News and SprottMoney.com, thanks for watching. We'll see you again in August.